who gets to decide what constitutes a person?
Well, I think it is the use of the word so-called choice, or I have my choice kind of scenario. It is actually a logical fallacy.
Welcome to Reason's podcast, dear friends. In today's episode, we are going to actually dive into a very important topic, and that is on the issue of pro-life. And in this important topic, we are also going to explore the different questions that is very, very central to this very topic. Questions such as, what does it mean to be human? And what is the value of life? And in particular, what is the value of the unborn life? To help us answer some of these questions, we have with us today Dr. Rajkumar Songa. He holds an MD degree in medicine. This is from the School of All India Institute of Medical Science, one of the leading prestigious medical school in our country in India. And he also currently is serving as the CEO of Center of Migration Medicines, where they deal with visa, especially in screening people who are migrating to different countries such as the United Kingdom and Australia, then Canada and New Zealand, and so on and so forth. We are glad to have Dr. Rajkumar here, and we welcome you to our podcast, to Reason's podcast.
Thank you, Dr. Bala, for the gracious introduction.
There is this latest National Family Health Survey that was done, wherein it shows that 3% of total pregnancies in India end up in abortion. And while 4% pregnant urban women opted for abortion. Now, the proportion was 2.5% among rural women. Now, there are many reasons for why people actually go through that, and we all know. So, the question for us today, what does a human life, or when does a human life begin, and what scientific evidence you would actually provide to talk about this unborn life?
Yes, it's a very painful topic in a sense, because this is a topic not of the mind, but of the heart. I want to say that first, because it is not about a mental decision as to the identity of whether this is a person or not, or a theological debate on whether it's a sin or not. It is a very painful aspect for many people for many reasons. And there are valid arguments on both sides of the argument. Having said that, we need to come to some kind of a clarity, because there is some clarity which is there, both from the scientific perspective and the theological perspective. It is good to look at those without demeaning or downplaying the arguments of the both sides of the argument. I think it's good to look at why people think the way they think. And I would say that if you asked firstly about the aspect of humanity when it begins versus identity, I would look first at the fact that from the perspective of a human being, the uniqueness of a human being comes from the specific DNA that's formed with the sharing of the chromosomes of the mother and the father. So it's very clear that you know that a distinctive identity is something that begins with that first fertilized ovum, where half of the genetic data is contributed by the father and half by the mother. That is the beginning of a new identity. Now, the new identity is a single cell called the zygote, or the fertilized ovum, right? That is where is the point of what's called conception. And conception is many a time taken as the point of an identity. Now the question comes is, does the identity match humanity? Very often people might say it's an identity, but is it human in the first place? Because we have the Aristotelian tradition, which even St. Augustine followed to a bit, of the way they look at the earlier stages of pregnancy as a vegetative state, and then comes a kind of a responsive but animistic or an animal state, and then comes a human state. So the fetus before it's born, as we use the word fetus. It has been looked upon as these three stages. And some have taken two stages, saying that the unformed substance or the unformed period versus the formed period. And they kind of differentiate to say that the implication for both regarding humanity is different. But if you go to the reductive aspect of going back to where identity begins, one cannot but come to the conclusion that unique identity, because that unique identity is not shared with anybody else in the world. Never in the past, never in the future.
Not even with the mother.
Not even with the mother, not even with the father. It's absolutely unique. And the interesting part is that these are the genetics not just of the mother and the father, but their mother and father, their mother and father, and it goes on generations back. So there is the physical identity that is imprinted upon this new entity, very unique. Regarding the fact that there is growth which happens from the unicellular stage to a multicellular stage and the first and second and the third trimester, and when you have stages of organ formation and systems formation, and finally into a mature fetus to be ready to be born, one might have an impression or an illusion of them being different. There is no biological discontinuity. In the mind, you may have a sense of behavioral discontinuity, in a sense, because you see a baby kicking, the fifth month, you see, I can sense the kick. Mm. And you see the biblical evidence, interestingly, when Mary goes to meet a pregnant Elizabeth. And we see the story of John, to be born John, responding to the to be born Jesus. It is not an encounter, yes. It is not an encounter of two human beings, it's an encounter of four human beings. And it is as if the fetus responded to Jesus in the womb, as there is darkness within the womb, so will your Savior share that darkness with you and bring you out of the tomb. The similarity of the womb and the tomb, in a sense. And that's the sense of joy probably John would have felt. I would say that the physical response is when people take it to be more human. And people imagine a biological discontinuity, but I think it's more artificial than for real.
Okay, thank you. I think what you are actually saying is that from a scientific point of view, there is uniqueness even in the unborn. Yes. So it is not just simply or merely a clump of tissues. There is a unique DNA which is quite different from the mother. And so that actually is one important scientific distinction. Now, you also mentioned about the story of the unique identity of Elizabeth, especially the baby or the birth of John, who was inside the womb. Now, what does the scripture actually talk about the uniqueness of the unborn? You've given us scientific evidence, but what does the scripture talk about the uniqueness of the unborn?
There is an interesting passage from Jeremiah which says, before I was born, I was appointed as a prophet to the nations. And there is a sense of even a destiny that's been set within the womb. And David talks about, in sin has my mother conceived me, talking about the fact that the stain of human sin, if you look at genetics as I was talking about, the imperfections in a sense, is something that's been genetic for him. In a way, he's declaring in his language, in sin has my mother conceived me, is a partaking of the human imperfections by sheer genetics. And the aspect of the breath of life is a different entity altogether, but I'll come to that later. But one of the most descriptive passages in scripture which takes us to the fetus as an entity that's worth speaking about is from Psalm 139, and especially from verses 30 to 16. I take the privilege of reading that passage. For you formed by inward parts, you knitted me, this is a Psalm of David. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. What's amazing about this passage is as if David had a kind of a camera which is looking into the room, and he was watching the creator,
like ultrasound,
and he's watching the maker knit the baby in the mother's womb. We do know that God has given power at the breath given to Adam, that there's a creative power that's been given at the word go, and it's become almost like an automated process. But the origins of the power is the breath of God, we know that, life itself. And he's attributing that and saying, he makes it more personal and brings it to this conclusion, saying, my frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret. And he goes on to say, your eyes saw my unformed substance. That's vital. The fact that he was him, even when he was still the so-called lump of flesh, not even looking like a shape of a human being, just a mass of a clump of flesh, he's identifying that as my unformed substance. I came from an unformed substance to become me is different from saying my unformed substance became something like a well-knit baby. I think there's linguistically, it is poetic, but there is that sense of identity which is clearly coming forth from the understanding of David in the Psalms, which was sung all over the Jewish land, that this is how we conceive or understand what a fetus is. So I would say that from a biblical perspective, Psalm 139 is key in understanding the way they perceive life, humanity, and identity all at once.
Wow. I really like the picture you brought right from the very beginning when you spoke from a scientific point of view. The uniqueness of the personhood actually lies in the unique DNA that each person, and especially the fetus, and that's the way in which all of us have come. And then again, the scriptures bringing that understanding of the continuity, for instance, of the personhood, when we are unborn and after we are born. And that is something that is very unique. Now, let me shift gears a little bit here. We've spoken about the uniqueness of this person, but then when you look at popular culture, there is so much of this conundrum or this confusion, and especially, I won't say confusion, but it is a narrative where people begin to argue on the basis of the right that we have. You know, when we speak of abortion, so people talk about pro-choice, and on the other extreme end is pro-choice, pro-life. So this is basically speaking of the human autonomy, the freedom that one has to actually do or to actually go for abortion. So so my question is, who gets to decide what constitutes a person?
Well, I think it is the use of the word so-called choice, or I have my choice kind of scenario. It is actually a logical fallacy.
Mm-hmm.
If I say that I have authority on my body, like I can get a tooth extraction done,
okay,
or I could have a gangrenous foot to be amputated, I make a choice, mm-hmm. and I have a prosthetic foot after that.
Mm-hmm.
They are parts of an entity. You're an individual.
Yeah.
The unique thing about a baby is, though within the body of another person, the mother, the interesting thing is, though dependent upon the mother, it doesn't constitute the fetus, if you can use, say, it, he, she, whichever way you want to put it. It, the fetus, is not a part or an extension like, say, a toe or a nail or hair or an eye of the person, on which the person has authority. this is an absolutely new individual. In that case, can you say just because there is an umbilical connection and the dependency of this new entity, can it be considered as a part of the body where you have autonomy over? It's good to think about that. And then, if this is an autonomous entity, what is it doing within the mother? And you can't use the word autonomy because it's completely dependent. But tell me, is it not true that when a baby is born, is a baby autonomous? The baby is dependent. Can a baby survive in a desert without somebody to help? The whole aspect of care and compassion, from a Christian perspective, from a human perspective, what is humane or human, is to care for the one who needs care and is dependent on someone else. There is a power dynamic there for a while. And the power dynamic is not something to be abused and said, because I'm more powerful than this powerless entity, I have an autonomy to do what I want to. One should recognize that if this is a person who's got his or her own autonomy, sooner or later, it would be evident. You're catching a person at a point of time that he or she seems to be dependent. Not going to be for long. Yes, it is a huge thing for a person to bear for 9 months. And you get a sense of possession. But the baby is not a possession of some kind of a sort, like I possess a pen or a phone. This possession is a fruit of love between the mother and the father, where it's come forth as a fruition coming as, that's why it's called the fruit of the womb in a sense. It is almost like the best manifestation of humaneness, or humanness, where you're perpetuating into the next generation. It's philosophically a very different thing actually, even if you think through on that. It is a delightful gift for the future to say, I am not going to be here to care for this world any longer. Here I give forth an entity, which after I pass away, shall be the one who caretakes whatever is around.
I like the word that you use when you speak about the autonomy of this entity or this life that is not yet born, while it is different. So when you speak of dependence, you know, when even old people tend to also depend
exactly
a lot, and but we never question their autonomy, and but then when it comes to the unborn, because sometimes when you speak about autonomy, when you speak about freedom to choose, we tend to make a lot of argument, especially when people are born, when persons are born. And I think there is that thin line where people tend to actually get confused when it comes to unborn, where they do not ascribe the same attributes as they would describe to someone who is already born. And so I really like that, because they are also dependent, and so is old people as well, or even us at many times when we are vulnerable. But now, having set the tone between the scientific basis for the uniqueness and then the scripture, giving the basis for the uniqueness of this personhood, now I would like to actually ask you, Doctor, what would you say, especially with regard to the different cases that actually people are compelled to go through abortion?
You know that in many cultures, the birth of a boy is celebrated and respected much more than the birth of a girl, on the assumption that the boy is going to carry the name of the family. And most cultures are patriarchal. And in such cultures, there is a tendency to look for the son to be born. And when a daughter is born, it can look like a disappointment. The paradox of this all is, without the girl, the man wouldn't have come in the first place. The very trajectory of a human being coming into being is through the woman in the first place, right? Physically.
Yes.
A man doesn't have the capacity to bear or have a womb in the first place. It's strange that, people have that kind of understanding. But no wonder rules have come into place in some countries where you cannot do a prenatal diagnosis of the gender and make a decision based on that, because there could be that temptation to go for an abortion, saying that, well, I wanted a son and here comes a girl, or here comes the girl when we already had a girl, or whichever way it is. Again, there you get to that autonomy aspect of choice. Having said that, the aspect of male versus female as a child, and the determination that happens, and the decisions that people make, is only one such scenario. There are scenarios, medical scenarios, like you were kind of attributing to, where there is a risk to the mother. For example, it's an ectopic pregnancy. It is not even in the right place in the womb. Right? It could be a tubules. And it eventually will not come to a fruition at all as a full-fledged fetus in the first place. And there are those which can burst and cause issues.
Issues with the mother.
Yes. So it's important to terminate that kind of pregnancy. Having said that, there are conditions where the risk to the mother medically can be a great issue, where the mother may not be able to survive because of that pregnancy, depending on how sick the person is already and she's become pregnant. Those are the areas, slowly we step into the gray areas as to how sick will the mother get, how fatal it is as a pregnancy. This is where a lot of liberty is taken. And people say, well, look, I have a low hemoglobin or anemia and I'm feeling weak, so I think it's going to be a risk to me. It's so different from someone saying, I have an ectopic pregnancy and it's anyway not going to go to fruition. Or there is a person with already a severe heart failure with a severe valvular heart disease and going through the strains of pregnancy and knowing well that it could be a big risk. That's one zone which is there. The other is about the maternal side of it. But there is the fetal side of things, where there could be chromosomal abnormalities which are discovered or detected or predicted based on a consanguineous marriage, which happens very commonly in a country like India, where we have first cousins marrying each other, second cousins marrying each other in certain cultures. And it is more likely for them to have more genetic disorders. Having said that, it's not that they would be fatal or something, but there would be some in existence. And there are other disorders also, genetic disorders and chromosomal abnormalities, which can lead to a child which can be considered as something less than a normal human being. That is where valuation comes into picture. Do we value it on a grade, or it's an either or situation? It's a binary 0 or 1 kind of scenario. Like some people joke, you can't be slightly pregnant. You are pregnant or not pregnant. In a sense, you are a human being or not human. It's not about you are less than human.
Okay.
This is a scenario where the liberty is taken from the maternal causes, as I said. People justify based on a whole spectrum of things which are risky to the mother.
Okay.
And it is to the discretion of the person to decide as to what is really significant to the point of a danger to the life of the mother, based on counsel from the medical side.
Mm.
And your own understanding of the symptoms. I think it is an area which has to be, you have to tread very cautiously on that zone of autonomy. And from the fetal perspective, it is no fault of the child that the person has a genetic disorder or a chromosomal abnormality. We don't know, it's multifactorial. And one can't put the blame on neither the mother, father, nor the child. And when it does happen, there is a temptation on the side of the parents to decide. It's going to be a huge strain financially for us and emotionally for us to be able to take care of such a child. What do we do? What do we do in this scenario? We can't handle it. There could be a mental status, say for example, a rape victim.
Okay. Yes.
And you have a scenario where, will she be able to carry the child of a perpetrator of such a terrible thing, a costly, and then see the reflection of that child each day with the perpetrator's face on him or her. It's a psychological challenge.
Okay.
And that is when people can make a decision from within their understanding about terminating the pregnancy, from what brought in the child. And this is where a totally different thing comes into picture. Just because you are unable to handle the thing, would you have the autonomy to abort the child? And this is where a response is important. And instead of a judgment on such a person, or such a scenario, or such a situation, it is good to see what is it that we can do to prevent such a thing.
What is it that we can do to prevent that situation?
So that the consequences are still borne and shared.
Collectively.
Collectively as a community. Rather than putting individualistically as, it's yours and I have nothing to do with it. No man is an island, says John Donne.
And this is where I think even culturally, we have lost that moral compass to kind of look at these issues from that point of deep concern, but rather we've come to a point where we've looked at these issues judgmentally, wherein we make certain judgments which pushes them to the fringes and compels them to take hasty decisions in such important matters.